Good morning again and welcome on this first day of daylight savings time. It came early. I'm proud to be here, thankful to see each and every one of you. Want to welcome our visitors, those who are watching from home. We hope you'll stay around just a little bit after worship. If you are visiting, let us get to know you, and you'll come back every chance you get. There are communion packages at the entries for the Lord's Supper, for the observance of the Lord's Supper. Is there anyone here that did not get a communion packet? If you would raise your hand, we'll make sure that one is brought to you right now. I'm seeing two over here. I've got two pairs of glasses. I've got my looky here glasses and my looky yonders. The looky here's don't do any good for looky yonder, so you have to maybe wave to get my attention. If you have a cell phone, an electronic tablet, something that's going to make a noise or squawk or go off or something, would you take a minute right now, turn it off, silence it, do something with it where it's not a distraction from us as we worship our Lord and Savior this morning. I appreciate you doing that now. We have a nursery. Craig, is they still two or is they just one? All right. All right. There's one back here in the front through them glass windows there, and another one back through yonder door. If you need help finding or using them, just see one of the ushers. They'll be more than happy to assist you with that. There are attendance cards on the back of the pews in front of you there. If you'd fill one of those out, we'd sure appreciate having a record of your attendance. If you have any special needs or prayer requests, you can put that down as well. You can drop them off at the collection trays by the exit or just leave it on the pew and it will be collected after the service. Before our opening prayer, would you join with me again in song, "I Come to the Garden Alone"?
Oh, Would you bow and pray with me as we go to God in prayer, please? Dear Lord, thank you so much for all that you do for us, Father. And we come before you at the beginning of our worship service, acknowledging every great and good thing that you do for us, Father. We appreciate so much you being the great God that you are, that you being in our lives, Father, that you care for us, that you watch over us, and that you want us to spend eternity with you. We're so grateful, Father, for that, and we strive every day to live up to all those good and gracious things that you've given us. Father, we're most especially grateful for your Son, for sending him to this earth, not only for your plan of salvation, but for the plan of him teaching us, Father, through his life, how we should live our lives. We pray, Father, for a closer walk with you in all that we do, so that when we have that opportunity, Father, we can believe you, we can obey you, we can follow in his footsteps, and know for sure, Father, that salvation is ours through his death, burial, and resurrection. Father, thank you so much for the spiritual blessings that you've given us and also the physical blessings. We know that we live in a country that our standard of living is far exceeds that of most nations, most people on this earth. And we consider that as you watchful, careful over us, Father, that we can have the freedom to share your word with those that we come in contact, whether that's by our good deeds, by our words, Father, or by studying your holy word. Let them see you through us. Father, thank you for this great place that we have to come and worship. We thank you for each individual that's out here this morning, as well as each family. We pray your richest blessings on them and on us, and that continues. Father, we know that our country is in strife, that there are many different opinions, and that the numbers indicate, Father, that fewer and fewer believe in you. And that makes us sorrowful, as I know it makes you sorrowful, Father. But we know that it's our responsibility to change that tide by letting them see you through us. Father, as we think about this service and we think about this place here, Father, that we worship, we pray your richest blessings on Scott and Doug and Ed as they lead, as well as Terry and Craig and Marcia. As they minister to this congregation, we pray that you give them the strength, the courage, and the knowledge to always execute their edification and encouragement of this group. Father, be with us as we go through this service. We are grateful that you are the I Am that we can worship, and we pray that we would remove everything from our minds that would distract from concentrating on what you do for us, what you have done for us, and what you've told us you will do for us. And all these things we ask in Christ's name. Amen.
My
Our hands are
The night before Jesus was crucified for our sins, he instituted the Lord's Supper. We read in the New Testament that Christians observe the Lord's Supper on the first day of every week. And so we do now. Matthew 26:26. And as they were eating, Jesus took bread, blessed, and broke it, and gave it to the disciples, and said, "Take, eat. This is my body." Father, we are so thankful for the bread which represents our Lord's broken body as he died on the cross in our place. May we focus our minds completely on Jesus and what he did for us. In his name we pray. Amen. Then he took the cup and gave thanks and gave it to them, saying, "Drink from it, all of you. For this is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for many for the remission of sins." Father, we are so thankful for this fruit of the vine, which represents the blood of Christ, which was shed on the cross for us. We are thankful to you for loving us and for Jesus, who loves us and washed us from our sins in his own blood. As we commune together, Father, may we remember Jesus' words, "Do this in remembrance of me." We continue our worship and thanksgiving to God in 1 Corinthians 16, verse 2, we read, "On the first day of the week, let each one of you lay aside, storing up as he may prosper, that there be no collections when I come." And then we read in 2 Corinthians chapter 8, verses 1 through 5, "Moreover, brethren, we make known to you the grace of God bestowed on the churches of Macedonia, that in a great trial of affliction, the abundance of their joy and their deep poverty abounded in the riches of their liberality. For I bear witness that according to their ability, yes, and beyond their ability, they were freely willing, imploring us with much urgency that we would receive the gift
and the fellowship of the ministering to the saints. And not only as we had hoped, but they first gave themselves to the Lord, and then to us by the will of God. Father, we are so thankful for the privilege to give back to you what you so freely have given to us. We are thankful for all the spiritual blessings we have in Christ Jesus. Help us to realize that all of our material blessings are from you. And may we who give first, as they did, what we give, that we may first give of ourselves to you. And what we give will be used for the work of your church here at South Trail. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. There are collection plates at both of the entrances, and also, if you wish, there's a number on the screen to give via text.
What a fellowship!
What a joy!
Reading this morning, I'd ask if it's convenient for you, would you stand while we sing this song and then remain standing for the scripture reading that will follow.
Oh,
If you'd like to follow along in the Bibles in the pew, I'll be reading page 774, Ecclesiastes chapter 12, verses 9 through 14. This is the conclusion of the wise man of the Old Testament. Verse 9. And moreover, because the preacher was wise, he still taught the people knowledge. Yes, he pondered and sought out and set in order many proverbs. The preacher sought to find acceptable words, and what was written was upright, words of truth. The words of the wise are like goads, and the words of the scholars are like well-driven nails, given by one shepherd. And further, my son, be admonished by these. Of making many books, there is no end, and much study is worrisome to the flesh. Let us hear the conclusion of the whole matter. Fear God and his commandments, for this is man's all. For God brings every work into judgment, including every secret thing, whether good or evil. You may be seated.
Thank you, sir. Appreciate it, brother. Yes, sir. It's great to see everybody here this morning. We're glad that you've come our way. We do have some folks that we have not previously had with us, and we have some that are back after being away for a period of time. So if spring break or just a respite from being in the cold has brought you down, or if you've come from around the corner, we're glad that you're here today. If you have a bulletin, there's an outline on the inside on the second page, and so that might help you as we follow along today a little bit. But we hope that as you are here with us, that our worship not only is pleasing to God, but also if it causes you to have a question or something that you want to ask about, we would love, and that is anybody here, ask one of the members, ask one of the elders, ask Craig or myself. We would love to be able to give you a reason for the hope that we have and the things that we do of our faith and of our practice. Katrina Stanford, her four-year-old boy came running into the room screaming, "My brother is going to kill me." Now Katrina knew that he was only four. She said, "Why would your brother want to kill you?" He said, "Because I dropped his toothbrush in the toilet." She said, "That's simple. You just go apologize to your brother and tell him that we will get a new one." He said, "I can't. He's in the bathroom brushing his teeth." It doesn't get more real than that, all right? Last week, we talked about made in the image of God, and we talked about we've been made in the image of God rationally. God gave us dominion over the earth. That means we have to have the mind, the capacity to understand concepts and even abstract ideas, to be able to have that dominion over the earth. And that dominion is a resemblance and a representation of God. As God is sovereign over all the universe, he's placed us in dominion here. He gave us dignity. All right? This is a work, and the stewardship of that responsibility gives us dignity. We are not here just to exist. We're not just kind of going through life aimlessly. God has given us purpose as we are here and as we are here together. And we have a responsibility for love. Because God made us in his image, he didn't just make me in his image, he made you in his image. We are all in the image of God. That means I need to respect you, I need to value you, I need to treat you as you are made in the image of God. That changes the dynamic. If we merely climbed out of some primordial soup, as the general theory of evolution teaches, then there would be no dignity, there would be no love, there would be no respect for one another. And in fact, much of the chaos we see in the world today is because people have been untethered from the mooring of a universal concept of right and wrong. So I want to talk today, the second lesson in this series, made in the image of God, morally. God has given us morals. The question there on your outline, what are morals? Do we have general standards of right and wrong? Have you ever heard, what the world needs now is Love. Well, that's a great idea, but who gets to define love? You see, the morals that God has given us are good for everybody. It puts us all on the same plane. The problem is that man's not content with love as God defines it and looking at what is generally best for another human being. What happens is, you see, if we have morals set by God, God is at the center. God is above. But what happens if someone, anyone, doesn't like those rules and they say, well, I want to be the center. I want to be at the center. I want to be the center of attention. I want to be at the center of who decides how others are treated or how they treat one another. See, love, by God's standard, is that God is the one who is above. God is love, and we must love one another as He has loved us. We love one another as we love ourselves, because we see that we are made in the image of God. So that love defines things. You ever played any game? I mean, any game. You don't have to play a complicated game like Monopoly, you know. Or some people play these card games. They play a thing called Bridge, okay? Never have understood it, you know. So understand, games can be very simple. Games can be very tough. Craig came in the office the other day and said, you want to play a game? I'm like, Craig, we're on the clock, you know. He goes, this won't take long. Seriously, he beat me in less than 2 minutes. All right. If you want to know what that game is, I'm sure Craig has them stocked up in his closet and he can sell those. But understand, it was a real fast game. It's one of those things. That's why he said we can do this even in the office. Games, though, have rules. And once you understand the rules, the game's fun. Doesn't mean you win all the time, but it means you can play the game according to those rules. If people have different rules, what happens to the game? Chaos. You know, it doesn't work. Because we're not following the same set of rules, and therefore the game doesn't make sense. Everybody's doing their own thing. Ah. See, when we look at society today, people are trying to set their own standard. They're trying to do their own thing, and they think that they can get away with it. But God gave us a universal standard. Murder, stealing, lying, adultery. These things are universally wrong, and they've been true in all cultures around the world. Sociologists cannot explain why these same moral standards are generally accepted. They are innate. It is not something that you are taught. It's not a cultural tradition. Why these things are universally accepted. There is something about the way God has made us to have those morals. How should we view justice? Should it be impartial? Should there be presumed innocence? Does it matter if a murderer goes free? I think all of you would be indignant, and you would say, of course it matters. In the Bible, I've given you several verses there from Deuteronomy 17:6 and Deuteronomy 19:15 to 20 in Numbers. All of these verses have to do with the fact that the way that the truth was established in a trial was that you had to have at least two witnesses, and they had to agree. They had to give the same set of facts, so it wasn't just somebody who saw something who went and told somebody, and then they tried to relate what they had been told. They were to be asked questions. There was to be an investigation, and God set up even cities of refuge so that people could flee to make sure that justice was done, but there was a presumption of innocence. You are innocent until proven guilty. And that worked. And God set that up through that standard of witnesses, and there is an obvious sense in which that works. Jesus even sets that up in Matthew chapter 18 in the church, that you don't just take one person, two people, if they have a problem, they try to work it out. If not, then you try to get some witnesses to try to work things out. So God intended for there to be a method by which justice could be blind. The scales of justice could be blind. Even a great jurist like William Blackstone in British law back in the 19th century said it would be better for 10 guilty people to go free. Listen to this. For 10 guilty people to go free than for one innocent person to be found guilty. Understand that presumption of innocence is something that's very important that justice is done, but not just because somebody made some claim or allegation. That happens quite often today, especially to people in public life, politicians, celebrities. Sometimes there is a presumption of guilt before there is innocence. And I would tell you that that's not the kind of justice that God intended for any of us. One of the things that God had said in Exodus 23 and verse 7 is that the false witness, he said, I will not acquit the wicked. If someone testifies falsely, they give false information, false witness account, then that is serious business in God's eyes. It cannot. Society must have rules. But how do we determine those rules? We mentioned before that God must be at the center. God must be above in order for everything else to work, function in a way that is fair. Sometimes what people say is that the rules are going to vary, and therefore what we end up with is a flip-flop. Let me give you an example of that. Now, I want to use this carefully, and I want you to understand. In our society today, there is a kind of a postmodern thought. Sometimes it's called progressivism. I want you to understand that progressivism is based on not love, but hate. There is an intent to put people in basically two categories or two classes. There are the oppressed, there are the oppressors. What progressivism tries to do is say that either by class or by color or nationality, you fall into one of these two categories, and the scales were uneven, so what they want to do is just flip it the other way. Now, I want you to understand that in that kind of system where it's not equal, we have a document that says all men are created. Y'all don't remember it? Okay. Equal. It doesn't mean we're the same, but we have the same value to God. It doesn't matter about your IQ. It doesn't matter about anything about where you live or how you dress, your economic status. No. All men are created equal in the eyes of God. We're different. We're not all the same. If we were all the same, in my mind, all men would be 6'2". That means cutting some of y'all down and giving the rest of us a boost. All right? But it doesn't work that way. When you think about this progressivism, where they put people in these two categories, they want to flip the scales and just say, well, we see some inequity, so we're going to do it this way. What does that do in the future? What's going to happen, in a few years, where somebody says, well, now I'm the oppressed. Now I'm the victim. I'm trying to do my whiny voice. Ask Gwen later if I did well, okay? I understand. The progressive, you know, that's going to lead to another, and then it's going to flip the other way. How about if we get it right? How about if we level the scale and we said everybody is created equal in the eyes of God and we're all going to be treated the same? How about that? Wouldn't that be the loving thing to do? To get away from the hate, to get away from the class, and to say we're going to look at people individually. If you have your Bibles, look at Matthew chapter 15. In Matthew chapter 15, Jesus is talking about, he said the Pharisees were coming down hard on Jesus and his disciples because they didn't wash their hands the way the Pharisees had created this tradition. So in Matthew chapter 15, look beginning of verse 18. He's talking about what really defiles. He goes, but those things which proceed out of the mouth come from the heart, and they defile a man. Not washing of hands, but the heart. For out of the heart proceed evil thoughts, murders, adulteries, fornications, thefts, false witness, blasphemies. These are the things which defile a man, but to eat with unwashed hands does not defile a man. Understand what Jesus says is there are individual sins. It's not a matter of us being judged as a group. God looks at us and he looks at each one of us individually. And that's how we're going to stand before God. Paul said in Romans 14, verse 12, so then each one of us must give account of himself, herself, to God. I don't know about you, but I'm thankful that I don't have to answer for other people. All right? I'm not saying that other people haven't lived their lives in a more exemplary fashion. I'm not saying there aren't other people that I look up to and admire, but I will tell you this. I only can choose for Terry. I don't get to choose for you or someone else. I don't choose for my parents. I don't choose for my children, my grandchildren. I don't choose for my neighbors. I'm only able to be responsible for me. And I will tell you this, the idea of being responsible for any other human being just weighs me down. I don't want to be responsible for another person. It's enough for Terry to be responsible for Terry. Just shake your head, okay? It's all I can do. Understand this morality that God has given us is meant for our good. Our conscience in Romans chapter 2, 14 and 15. Even those who don't have the law, the Gentiles still did the things that were in the law because they knew better. They knew what was right and they knew what was wrong. We are made in the image of God morally. Why? Let's look at this for a moment. Number one, God created mankind, male and female, for intimacy. A relationship. God wants fellowship with us. When Adam and Eve were in the Garden of Eden, they walked and talked with God. That song we sang, "My God and I." My God and I, we walk together. My God and I enjoy that relationship. It's something that flows because if I care and love God, God is there with me. Oh, I don't mean that God audibly talks to me. What I mean is that I know through the Scriptures what God, how to draw near to God, how to respect and love God, and God will help me. God blesses me. God gives me that sense, presence. There was a young woman not too long ago who attempted to take her life. And the reason she said was, she goes, "I just don't have the strength that it takes to keep going, just existing." That is a sorrowful way to live. To just feel like you're existing, to just be getting by. What Jesus said is, "I came that you might have life and have it more abundantly." God doesn't want you to just exist. He doesn't want you just going through the motions day after day. He doesn't want you asking the question, "When will this end?" Let me ask you a question. If I ask you about Jesus coming back, how do you feel? Do you get excited? You say, "Whoopee! I'll never run for office after that," okay? Understand, if Jesus is coming back, are you excited or are you afraid? Or is it you don't have any feelings at all? Is Jesus your friend? Is Jesus the one that you turn to? Is Jesus the one that you listen to? Is Jesus the one you say, "That's my example"? He's the one who guides me and shows me how I can get the most out of life. Jesus helps us to be able to see God. Abraham is said to have bargained with God in Genesis 18. God shared with Abraham that he was going to destroy the cities of Sodom and Gomorrah for their open disregard, disobedience for what God had said. Their open disobedience caused God to say, "That's enough." Abraham said, "Well, wouldn't you save the city if there were 50 righteous?" God said, "Yes." 45? Yes. 40? Yes. 30? Yes. 20? 10? Yes. Abraham, I think, knew he needed to stop there. But there weren't even 10 righteous people. Not even 10 people who listened or cared what God said. Not 10 people who wanted fellowship with God. Not 10 people who were seeking God. See, when we talk about morality, it's not just some cold, sterile treatment of one another. It's being able to see each other through the eyes that God made us in His image. Are men and women the same or different? We have a thought today, that the egalitarian thought that says, well, men and women are exactly the same. I can tell you that from my biology class here at Riverview High School, just a little over maybe a mile away as the crow flies, men and women are not the same. We were taught in biology that there were differences. If you haven't figured that out, talk to me privately. But understand that just like we're treated or we've been made male or female there according to Genesis 1:27, it's not a choice. You don't get to say, "Well, I want to be something different." We talk about follow the science. Well, according to the DNA, you're male or female, and no surgery, no hormonal treatments, no medications or other psychological, behavioral concepts are going to change your DNA. You need to understand, and you need to be able to accept that. There is reality. If I wake up in the middle of the night and say, I want it to be day, well, I guess we can move the clock forward an hour. That would be. I don't get to change night and day. I don't get to relocate the sun. I don't get to change or alter the laws of the universe. I get to live within those. And one of those laws that God has made is He made you male or female. He made you one, and you are going to be that one for your entire life. And there's no changing that. And any pretending or any kind of other attempts are merely futile, and they will lead to more complications, more chaos, and more psychological problems. Besides the spiritual problem, that you're not honoring the God who made you. If you dishonor God as far as being male or female, how do you honor God as far as being moral? How do you honor God as far as treating others, to value them? One of the verses that is often misused, take your Bibles and look at Galatians chapter 3. I want you to listen to something, and I want you to realize something. God does, He's made us all equal. God values us equally in the sense that the intrinsic value is because God's got His stamp, His image on you. In Galatians chapter 3, beginning verse 26, for you are all sons of God through faith in Christ Jesus. For as many of you as were baptized into Christ have put on Christ. He's talking about the terms, the conditions in the gospel for receiving, to having appropriated all the spiritual blessings, beginning with the forgiveness or the remission of sins, salvation, the inheritance, regeneration, redemption. Notice in verse 28. There is neither Jew nor Greek, there is neither slave nor free, there is neither male nor female, for you are all one in Christ Jesus. And if you are Christ, then you are Abraham's seed and heirs according to the promise. Some read that in verse 28 and say, well, see, there's neither male nor female. I get to choose. That's not what that means. What that verse is talking about, as he puts different categories, and even Jew or Greek, salvation is available to all. It's not something you didn't have to wait, like suffrage, to be able to vote, ladies. Salvation through Jesus Christ and the gospel is for everyone. We preach it to everyone, the whole world. It's not something we say, well, it's only for the men. You see, what it says there in that verse is not that all of a sudden fathers lose their fatherhood or manhood. It's not that women lose their motherhood or their womanhood. It's that we have the availability of salvation. Everyone is eligible for God's grace. What a blessing. God didn't pick and choose. He didn't say, I'm only going to give this to America. No. The whole world. Everyone has this opportunity. So what we see is that God designed this for his power. What did God do with marriage? God knew that it was not good for man to be alone. He gave us someone that we could have and share the most closest, the most dear, the most intimate relationship in the world. And He gave us in that the intimate relationship, the sexual relationship for a man, a husband, and his wife. One. One man, one woman. That's what marriage is. And if anyone tries to redefine that, it's missing all the elements that God intended. He intended that not only for the pleasure of the couple, the intimacy, the knowledge of the couple, the fellowship, also for procreation so that they could have a family. It's interesting to me that as people try to come up with all different kind of definitions of marriage, that they still can't create procreation unless they follow God's pattern. God intended it to be that way in order for there to be the fullness, to be able to multiply and fill the earth. There is something else in marriage, and I have to stop and mention this. If there is anything that marriage teaches us, it teaches us forgiveness. Forgiveness. We need to forgive one another. Even the secular author, Brian Tracy, wrote this, forgiveness is a purely selfish act. You forgive others so you can be emotionally free. You know, he's got part of that right. We need the emotional freedom that forgiveness brings, but it's not selfish. It resembles God. To forgive someone genuinely and deeply and spiritually is to do what God has done in Jesus Christ. Jesus said in Matthew 6:14, "For if you forgive men their trespasses, your heavenly Father will forgive you." I guess there is an element of selfishness there, but to do it right. And Jesus said, "But if you do not forgive men their trespasses, neither will your Father in heaven forgive you." I need to forgive people because I need to be forgiven. If I don't forgive you or anyone else, all I'm doing is blocking the very thing that God has offered and I need more than anything. Secondly, God created mankind to be social. You look at Genesis chapter 4 with Cain and Abel. One of the saddest things is you've got two brothers. They ought to be able to have a friendly rivalry, you know, that sibling nature, but it ought to be something that works out good. But Cain sees the sacrifice of Abel is accepted by God. Read Hebrews 11:4. What Abel did, offered a blood sacrifice, an animal, God accepted because that's what God told him he wanted. Cain brought something from the fruit of the ground. It was not representative of the sacrifice that God was looking for to represent what sin is. As sin separates us from God and sin brings death, God wanted a blood sacrifice, an animal sacrifice, to be the type that would picture ultimately what Christ would do. Cain killed Abel, and of course God holds him to account. And you know, Cain tries to say that, "Am I my brother's keeper?" Well, yes, you are. We have a responsibility for each other. And we need to show that responsibility as we love one another. But then what happens with Cain is Cain is driven out. He's to be punished. But he says there in verse 13, "My punishment is greater than I can bear." Just think, being an outcast back in the early world where all of a sudden you're away from everybody. You're all alone. Folks, that is not what God intended. He made us to be social. And so that punishment, God says, "Well, I'll put a mark on you so nobody is going to take revenge. So no one will kill you in the future." And so he gives him some leniency. He gives him a blessing there of a reprieve so that he has that restoration of social. But still, think about it. Cain knew the punishment was deserved. But it was more than what he could stand. Sometimes with our understanding of morals, we need to see. And that teaches us that God is the one who judges the world. Whether it was the flood, it was God judging. Whether it was the Tower of Babel, it was God judging. Whether it was Sodom and Gomorrah or on any other occasion, God is the one who is the ultimate and the final judge. And we need to remember that all the time. "Vengeance is mine, says the Lord. I will repay." Romans 12:19-20. God is the one who carries the ability. Why? Because God knows. How many of you are mind readers? How many of you can understand the motives or judge the heart? That's why Jesus said, "Do not judge," because you don't know what's going on inside. It's not that you can't judge the actions, but at the same time, you can't judge the internal, the spiritual part of that. Number three, God created morality for man to be right with him. He gives us righteousness. In Romans chapter 1, verses 18 to 32, Paul says that's part of it. And that's even part of the preaching. I know that that's not always. People are like, well, Terry, why do you have to preach on that? Well, I don't like it when you preach those kind of sermons where you lay out what's wrong. We need to understand what's right and wrong, or we won't be right with God. We've sinned, but it's not because we do it, because we want to. In Galatians chapter 3, verses 19 to 21, what there Paul writes and talks about is this exact idea that he wants them to understand. He says in verse 21 of Galatians 3, "Is the law then against the promises of God? Certainly not. For if there had been a law given which could have given life, truly righteousness would have been by the law." Our righteousness is the thing that we are in a right standing with God. God wants us to be right, and that requires the knowledge of sin. And that requires gospel preaching for us to understand what sin is and what it brings as a consequence. Finally, look there, man is guilty, but God offers grace. God's wonderful, unmatchable, inexpressible, indescribable grace. The gift that he has given us through Jesus Christ. I heard about a Canadian pilot. The plane crashed. The pilot had seen a low fuel light. The pilot ignored it because when they were stopped, he was just sure that the ground crew had filled the plane with fuel. He ignored the warning light. And everyone that was on board received the consequence, the peril of that Canadian jet, because the pilot did not ignore the light. Our preaching must expose our guilt, not to leave us there, but to explain to us why God's grace is so important. It is so critical. It is the greatest gift in all the world. And God's love is something that will bless your life. It is something. God knows even the depth. It uncovers, according to Psalm 19, 13, and 14, the hidden sins, the presumptuous sins that we have in our heart. The Word of God helps to reveal those things so that we can be able to confess and find that. Paul says the very mission in Acts 26, verses 16 to 18 of him preaching was for that salvation. Because sinners needed to know the saving power of the gospel of Jesus Christ. It's not that we want to talk about sin and stop there. We want to talk about sin and then talk about the solution. Jesus Christ gave his life so that you and I could have forgiveness. Sin, though, is like quicksand. The more we fight to try to justify or rationalize or minimize it, the more it takes us over. That quicksand will cause you to sink and cause you to lose everything if you stay in that quagmire. But God wants us to be made in the image of God. It means we represent God. In 2 Corinthians chapter 5, listen to what Paul says about the beauty of what Christ. Now all things are of God, who has reconciled us to himself through Jesus Christ and has given us the ministry of reconciliation. That is, that God was in Christ reconciling the world to himself, not imputing their trespasses to them, and has committed to us the word of reconciliation. Now then, we are ambassadors for Christ, as though God were pleading through us. We implore you on Christ's behalf, be reconciled to God. The beauty of the gospel is that we can have the forgiveness of our sins. The beauty of the gospel is that we can have the hope of eternal life. You don't want this to be all there is. You don't want this to be to end with being separated from God and in a place of punishment or loss for all eternity. The gain is all in Christ. The beauty, the blessings are all in Christ. Andrea Mosconi, for a number of decades, had the privilege of being able to protect, to maintain some of the most precious violins in all the world. And why not? He was there in Cremona, Italy. And so there, he was able, every day, he would put on a tie, a suit and a tie, and he would open up these cases with these most valuable treasures of violins, and he would play each violin for 6 to 7 minutes every day. And we're talking about Amati, Guarneri, and Stradivari, some of the most special prized violins in all the world. Why did he do that? Because if they were left unattended, they would deteriorate. But by playing them, it helped them to maintain their sweet, beautiful music. For you, we're made in the image of God. We're made in the image of God morally. On earth, we represent God. Morally, we represent God to hold up that standard that God wants, that keeps everybody on the same plane, treats everybody the way that God wants to treat them. This morning, are you a Christian? When we talk about the return of Jesus, does it give you excitement to think that Jesus is coming back? Or you just say, well, I don't know if I'm ready. If you've never obeyed the gospel, you're not ready. But if you obey that gospel, you can have the sweet, blessed assurance that when Jesus returns, you know where you're going. There's a home waiting for those who have been washed in the blood of Jesus. If you believe in Christ and you've repented of your sins, Ananias came to Saul of Tarsus. He said, why are you waiting? Arise and be baptized. Be immersed, calling on the name of the Lord and washing away your sins. You want your sins washed away, you can have that today. If you are a Christian and you realize that you haven't been representing the image of God the way that you want to, make that right today. If it's something there that you want your brothers and sisters to help you, to encourage you, to pray with you, step down to the front today. Whatever your need is, God invites you for him to bring the solution right now while we stand and while we sing.
Shall we pray? Lord, we're thankful to you for allowing us to come this morning into your presence and to worship you and praise you with songs and prayers, and giving thanks to you for the love and the mercy that you show to us every day. That love and mercy we know, dear Lord, as we have just said, we need you. We need you every hour. And we do know that you are close by. We do know that whatever our needs are, your mercy is there, your love is there for us. And we are grateful to you for loving us so much that you sacrificed your son for us, so that through the shedding of his blood that we would have forgiveness of our sins. And we pray for your continued mercy and forgiveness. For we are human and we sin daily. We do need you, Lord. Lord, we pray for our missionaries around the world. We know that many of them are struggling in with the governments that they are working under. We know that many are struggling with physical needs. We pray, dear Lord, that you will be with each one of them. Keep them safe, give them good health. And we pray that the gospel message that they are delivering falls into open minds and open hearts. We are thankful for Terry and for Craig, for these men of of yours that we pray that they will have good health as they continue to help us to understand thy word, as they continue to encourage each and every one of us here. We pray, dear Lord, that you will help us to help others to have open minds and open hearts to hear your word, to hear it taught. And we pray, dear Lord, that each one of us will reject those that are false teachers, those that are spreading what they are calling your word and that we know is not true. We pray, dear Lord, that you will guide each and every one of us to stay true to the path that you show us throughout your word. Lord, there are many in this congregation and that are in our knowledge that are fighting illnesses, and we know that they have tests and procedures and surgeries and things that are scheduled, and we pray that you as a great physician will watch over them, and we pray that they will get favorable results from their tests, and we pray that you will help guide those that are caring for them. Lord, as we go about our daily activities this week, help us to always strive to be a good example to those, and pray that the things that we do reflect the light that you shine upon us, the light that you give us to light our path. We pray that this light reflects on others through our goodness and love for the others. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. I have a few announcements here. And first of all, we welcome each and every one of you here, members and visitors alike. And we say to our visitors, whether you're here for a few months or if you're here for a few days, we welcome you here. We thank you for choosing to come and worship with us here. We are enriched by each and every one of you when you